he chanted. We sing, hands in sleeves, and lean on the rails. At once he asked the Office of Music to set the poems to music and perform them. They spent the day that way before dispersing. Meanwhile, Pilgrim and his two companions also abandoned themselves to enjoyment at the spring detaining arbor. Growing somewhat tipsy from the several cups of wine they each consumed, they were about to leave to look for the elder when they spotted him in a distant room with the king. His silly nature aroused, Eight Rules shouted. What great fun! What comfort! Today I've had my enjoyment. As long as I'm full, it's time to take a snooze. Second elder brother, said Sha Monk, chuckling. That's not very dignified of you. With such a full stomach, how can you sleep? Eight Rules said. You wouldn't know about this. The proverb says, if after a meal you don't lie flat, your belly won't get fat. The Tang monk took leave of the king and went to the arbor, where he rebuked Eight Rules, saying, you coolie. You're getting rowdier. What sort of a place is this that you dare to shout and holler? If the king takes offense, you may lose your life. It's nothing. It's nothing, replied Eight Rules. After all, we are related to him as in-laws, properly speaking, and he can't be offended by us. As the saying goes, you can't cut off your kin with beating. Nor can you your neighbor with scolding. We're all having some fun. Why worry about him? Bring that idiot over here, snapped the elder. Let me give him 20 strokes with my priestly staff. So Pilgrim pulled him over and bent him down, while the elder raised his staff to strike. Father Royal Son-in-Law, cried Idiot. Please pardon me. Please pardon me. Those officials who had borne them company during the party persuaded the Tang monk to stop. Scrambling up, our idiot could be heard muttering. Dear honored man. Dear royal son-in-law. The wedding hasn't even taken place, and you're administering royal law already. Putting his hand over Eight Rules' mouth, Pilgrim said. Stop jabbering. Stop jabbering. Hurry and go to sleep. They spent another night in the spring detaining arbor, and by dawn, they feasted once more. They passed 3 or 4 days in such pleasure, and the auspicious day of the 12th arrived. The officials from the 3 departments of the Court of Imperial Entertainments came to say, since receiving your decree on the 8th, your subjects have now finished building the royal son-in-law's residence, though we are still waiting for the dowry to furnish the place. The wedding banquet, too, is prepared. Altogether, both vegetarian and non-dietary, there are some 500 tables. Delighted, the king wanted to ask his son-in-law at once to attend the banquet, when an official of the inner palace suddenly appeared and said, Your Majesty, the queen wishes to have an audience. The king went inside, and found the queens of the 3 palaces and the ladies of 6 chambers, chatting merrily with the princess at the Zhaoyang Palace. Truly, they were like bouquets of flowers and rounds of brocade. All that opulence could rival even that of the lunar palace in heaven, and it certainly was not inferior to the divine Jasper residence. As a testimonial, we have 4 new songs based on the words of joy, meet, fine, and mate. The song of joy says, joy, joy, joy. This happiness in joy. A matrimony of love most seemly. Such smart palace fashion would rouse Chang'e's passion. Those dragon and phoenix hairpins of luminous gold threads thin. Those lustrous teeth and cherry lips. A body light as flower slips. Layers of silk within the 5 colored groves. Lovely fragrance rising from beauties in droves. The song of meat says, meat, meat, meat. One seductive and sweet. Maotiang Shu rivals. And Chu maids equals. A wrecker of city and state. Fair like flower and jade. Her makeup is fresh and charming. Her jewels are more disarming. An orchid mind and nature lofty. And ice white flesh and face most stately. Like distant hills, her dark brows are painted thin. The regiment of silk, she's fairest therein. The Song of Fine says, "Fine, fine, fine, a maiden divine, profoundly lovely, truly praiseworthy. Rare fragrances combine with powder and carmine. The blessed Tian tie off somewhere. Could it with a royal house compare? She speaks and smiles in form so fair, as pipes and music both rend the air. Pretty are a thousand forms of flower and silk. Scan the whole world, but none is in her ilk." The Song of Mate says, "Mate, mate, mate, the orchid scents dilate. Immortal crowd, and beauty's proud. The maiden's colors fresh born, the princess newly adorned. Her coiffure rises like a crow's nest, phoenix skirt beneath a rainbow vest. Celestial sonorities ahead, two rows of lovely purple and red. In years past, she had fixed a nuptial date. This day she's happy to meet her fine mate. We tell you now about that king, who arrived in his carriage. The queen led the princess, along with the consorts and palace maidens, to meet him. Cheerfully the king entered the Zhaoyang palace to take his seat. After the ladies had bowed to him, the king said, 'Princess, our worthy daughter, we trust that the happy meeting with the sage monk, when you tossed the ball from the festoon tower on the 8th, has given you great satisfaction. The officials of various bureaus and departments, moreover, have been so considerate of our interests that all the preparations are now completed. Today is the auspicious day. You must make haste to attend the wedding feast, so that the goodly hour will not be forfeited.' Stepping forward, the princess went to her knees to bow low and said, 'Father King, please pardon your daughter's 10,000 offenses. There is a matter about which I must speak to you. For several days, I have heard the palace officials say that the Tang monk has 3 disciples who are exceedingly ugly. Your daughter dares not face them, for they will surely cause me great fear and dread. I beg the Father King to send them out of the city, so that my feeble body will not be harmed by fright nor our happiness ruined. If our child hadn't spoken of this matter,' replied the king, 'we would have overlooked it. They are indeed quite hideous and wild. These past few days, we've entertained them at the spring detaining arbor in the royal garden. We'll take this opportunity today to go up to the hall and certify their rescript. After they have been sent out of the city, we'll then hold our banquet.' The princess kowtowed to express her thanks. The king at once rode his carriage to the main hall, where he issued a summons for the royal son-in-law and his 3 disciples. Now the Tang monk too had been counting the days with his fingers. When he reached the 12th, he began even before dawn to discuss the matter with his disciples, saying, 'Today's the 12th. How are we to settle this affair?' 'I could tell,' said Pilgrim, 'that the king has a certain gloomy aura about him. It has not, however, penetrated his body yet, and I don't think it will cause him any great harm. But I still haven't had a chance to see the princess. If only she would come out. With one glance, old monkey can tell us whether she is real or not, and only then can we do anything. You shouldn't worry, though. Today, they will certainly call for us in order to send us 3 out of the city. You should accept the summons without fear. In the twinkling of an eye, I'll be back at your side to give you protection.' As master and disciples talked, the attendant to the throne and the director of ceremonies indeed arrived with a summons. Chuckling, Pilgrim said, "Let's go. Let's go. We are about to be sent off, while master will remain for the marriage. To send us off," said 8 rules, "they must present some 1,000 taels of gold or silver. That'll be enough for me to get some gifts to go back to my in-laws. We'll have another wedding and a little fun. Clamp your mouth, second elder brother, and stop blabbering," said Sha Monk. "Just let big brother make the decision." They took the luggage and the horse to follow the various officials to the vermilion steps. When he saw them, the king asked the 3 disciples to approach him, saying, "Bring us your travel rescript. We shall use our treasure seal on it. In addition, we shall increase your travel allowance and wish you a speedy arrival at the Spirit Mountain to see Buddha. When you return with the scriptures, there will be further reward. The royal son-in-law will remain here, and you need not worry about him." Thanking him, Pilgrim asked Sha Monk to take out the rescript to hand over to the king. The king read it before applying his seal and affixing his signature. Then he presented them with 10 ingots of yellow gold and 20 ingots of white gold as wedding gifts. As he had always been both lecherous and greedy, 8 rules immediately took them, while Pilgrim gave a bow and said, "Much obliged. Much obliged." He turned and began to walk out. Tripitaka was so startled that he scrambled up and caught hold of Pilgrim. Teeth grinding audibly, he said, "Are you all abandoning me?" Squeezing Tripitaka's palm with his hand, Pilgrim winked at him and said, "Relax and enjoy your union here. When we have acquired the scriptures, we'll return to see you." The elder seemed not to believe him and refused to let go. The other officials, however, thought that master and disciples were indeed bidding each other farewell. Then the king asked the royal son-in-law to ascend to the hall once more, while the other officials were to see the disciples off outside the city. The elder had to loosen his grip and went back to the hall. Pilgrim and his 2 companions went out of the gate of the court and took leave of the officials. "Are we really leaving?" asked 8 rules. Without saying a word, Pilgrim walked back to the post house, where they were received by the post house clerk. As he went to prepare rice and tea, Pilgrim said to 8 rules and Sha Monk, "You 2 stay here and don't show yourselves. If the post house clerk questions you, just muddle through with some answer. Don't speak to me at all, for I'm leaving to go protect Master. Dear great sage." He pulled off a piece of hair, blew his immortal breath on it, and cried, "Change." It changed at once into a form of himself, which remained with 8 rules and Sha Monk in the post house. His true self leapt into midair and changed into a bee. You see his yellow wings, sweet mouth, and sharp tail. A mad dancer lost in the gale. Most able to pick the buds and steal their scent. To make through willows his descent. He submits to both stains and dyes. Hither and yon vainly he flies. Ne'er tasting that sweetness he helps distill. He has but his name for a will. Look at him. Ever so lightly he flew into the court, where he found the Tang monk sitting most dejectedly and with furrowed brow on a brocade cushion to the left of the king. Alighting on his Vero Cana hat, he crawled near his ear to whisper, "Master, I'm here. Please don't worry." Those few words, of course, were audible only to the Tang monk and to none of those other mortals. When the Tang monk heard them, he felt more reassured. In a little while, a palace official came to say, "Your Majesty, the wedding banquet has been laid out in the Magpie Palace. The Queen and the Princess are waiting there for the presence of Your Majesty and the Honorable Man." The king could not have been more pleased. At once he took the royal son-in-law inside the palace. Thus it is that the deviant lord loves flowers, though flowers bring woe. The Chan mind stirs to thought, but thought begets sorrow. We do not know how the Tang monk in the palace will find deliverance, and you must listen to the explanation in the next chapter.